Mental health is, in lots of ways, just like physical health. Some of us are generally healthy, with a few wobbles along the way, like the odd cold or stomach bug, whilst others of us are weighed down with more severe or longer term illnesses. My experience has been more similar to that second description, and that has been especially so in the last 6 years. I'm not entirely sure of all the whys and hows, but somehow the combination of old trauma, a recent stressful situation, general tiredness, and I guess some wonky brain chemistry meant that I was struck down with depression and anxiety around Christmas time in 2014. It's hard to explain how it feels if you haven't gone through it yourself, and I think everyone's experience is different. But for me, I found the whole thing to be pretty frightening. Depression sometimes feels sad, but mostly feels heavy and numb. I remember one morning looking at myself in the mirror and starting to cry, not really sure why I was crying, and then not being able to stop for the next 3 hours. The fact that I didn't know the reason for my tears made me scared, which made stopping even harder. Anxiety is something different altogether. There's nothing numb about it. Most of the time it's a general low-level dread, like when you've got an exam coming up. And then every so often it turns into panic, but without a real reason to be afraid. I could be sitting alone in my room or walking down the street or hanging out with people, maybe even mid-conversation, and this sudden feeling of terror washes over me. I feel hot and cold at the same time, my heart starts racing, my skin starts crawling, and I just want to run away, but there's nothing to run away from. I started taking an antidepressant called citalopram, and I've kept taking it since then, two pills once a day for 6 years. It helps to keep me on a more even keel. There's still low moments, but they're a lot less severe than they were. The anxiety is still there, but is again mostly less severe and much, much easier to manage. I have been blessed with the gifts of friends and family who were and continue to be very, very kind. But a few particularly notable things. People who encouraged me to go to the doctor and make use of what was on offer, both medicine and talking therapy, and who keep reminding me to take my pills, because despite the fact there has been 6 years now, I'm still not great at remembering to do that. Friends who let me come and sit in their houses, drink their tea, eat their food, cry on their shoulders, sit in silence, and sometimes just let me move in for a few days have been brilliant. Church family who prayed with me and for me, who didn't ever make me feel like I was failing as a believer, and who kept pointing me towards Jesus when I was finding it hard to remember him as well. If you're struggling at the moment, then that is quite understandable. Life right now is very hard, and even the most healthy people are going to be finding things tricky. If you're predisposed to mental illness, or you are already struggling, then this season of life isn't going to have helped. So give yourself a break. Make use of the resources on offer. Go to your GP, speak to your student support services, and take advice from professionals as to whether medication or counselling might be helpful for you. Speak to friends and older people at church and let them look after you. Mental health struggles don't make us bad Christians, but they can make the Christian life harder sometimes. When you're struggling with any kind of illness, you might find it harder to pray or read God's word or participate in church life. But the Bible teaches us that we're never meant to do the Christian life on our own. One of the reasons that we're given the gift of church is so that we will be in a Christian community where we're able to serve others and they are able to serve us. And when we're struggling, we need that community most of all to pray for us, to read the Bible for us, to help us participate in church life. As Christians, we're called to encourage one another with the gospel, so allow others the blessing of serving you in this way. And then two final pieces of advice, if I can. First, don't believe the lie that mental illness disqualifies you from serving God. We've been taught by our culture that weakness is bad, and that we need to pull ourselves together and sort ourselves out. But the gospel speaks against that every turn. You can't sort yourself out. None of us can. That's why Jesus had to come to die in our place and to be raised to life again. And his work doesn't stop there. He's still working in us and through us. And Paul reminds us in 2 Corinthians that God works through our weakness, not in spite of it. God's power is made perfect in weakness. Second, know that God is love and that he really does love you. When you feel unworthy and unlovable, hold on to the very good and true truth. God loves you so much that he sent his own son to die for you and make it possible for you to be part of his family. Not because you'd earned it, but because he is good and kind and loves you. Nothing can separate you from that love. Not depression or anxiety or self-harm or an eating disorder or bipolar or schizophrenia or any other illness that is wearing you down right now. He is love and he loves you.